started. Actually, I'll give everyone just a moment to connect to the Wi-Fi. Has anyone had trouble connecting, getting the PDF at all? It should be a Google Docs. Or Dropbox, that's right. It's a Dropbox. At the end, I'll have another QR code that takes you to a Google Docs. I'll have it available, the code available at the end as well. My name is Benjamin Guerrero. I am a PhD student at Eastman School of Music. I'm researching music technology in music education. I want to figure out what works, what doesn't work, and why. Previously, I went to Berklee College of Music for a performance degree on drum set, and also a degree called Contemporary Writing Production. So it's half audio production degree, half arranging composition. And then I went to NYU for my master's in music technology, so I got to see a little bit different side of technology. And then I taught for 5 years at community college and working with multiple high schools and middle schools in Texas. And I had a chance to teach a music fundamentals class and an electronic music 1 and 2 class at the community college and at the same time. And in my students, not all of them were music majors, had music backgrounds, and I felt like I had to teach music fundamentals in my music technology class. And I was also using technology to teach music fundamentals in my music fundamentals class. So that's how I came up with this topic. We're gonna have to define a couple of things so we're all on the same page. How do we define music technology? It's used a lot, it's like a buzzword. Tech this, 21st century that. And I want us to have a very broad definition of music tech so that it can apply to you and your classroom and the technology that you have. So it's simply the use of any tool to create music. So I'm not saying computers or apps or smartphones. It's any tool. Even the instruments that we use can be considered a form of technology. Think of the natural horn. We had to get the hoops to change keys. And then we added vowels to the horn, and composers could then change the way they were composing music. They were limited by technology, and then they could advance the way they compose music because the horn could play chromatically. Think of the piano itself. During Bach's time, the piano wasn't really a mature instrument, so Bach didn't really compose for the piano. By the time Mozart started composing for the piano, it was already a well-developed instrument. It was a pianoforte. By the time Beethoven got it, he wanted it to be more expressive, and we had increased dynamic range and increased upper registers and lower registers of the piano. It should have been called the pianissimo fortissimo at that point. It's a new instrument, and the composers are adapting to it. So in the context of a music technology class, it could be a music class where digital tools are the primary medium of instruction, rather than just the instruments that we're using or we're singing. That can happen in a music technology class, but in this case, the medium of instruction would be a technology device of some kind. So in your classroom, it may be one of these things. This is pretty broad. This is not everything, but how many of you have used any of these things in your classroom? Yeah, so it could be passive or it could be active digital tools that we can be using in our classroom. The other part of my title, teaching music technology classes, musically? Well, musically could be subjective, absolutely. And within music education, there are different philosophies of music education. So you may or may not be familiar with some of these philosophies of aesthetics, education, practicalism, musicking, or an open philosophy, which is a little bit newer. But one thing that's happening over time is the aesthetic is more performance-based, more beautiful music. And you want all our students to make beautiful music. And then it starts broadening and opening up, talking about more music that's human and the process of making music, the practice of making music, and how that could be different for everyone. And then everyone that's involved in making music will also can be involved in what we call music education. So my definition of musicianship, or musicality, or however you want to spin it, again, is a little broad. I'm simply saying the ability to understand, create, and communicate music. So for me, communicate would include listening and responding to music. And in music tech class, it's the same exact thing. We are understanding, creating, and communicating music simply with technology. So here's the top half of this list, or what we typically expect of musicianship skills in a classroom. Performing, composition, arranging, music theory, ear training, audiation, improvisation. The bottom half is where we can get a little bit more broad and soften our definition of musicianship. Collaborating, practicing skills, teaching skills, technology skills, using technology and teaching with technology. There are music leaders and music advocates that are working behind the scenes, making sure everyone can have the ability to make music. And they are also participating in what we call musicianship. And being a leader, being an advocate for music, is also a skill that can be taught. So I want to focus on two of these musicianship skills: the ear training or oral skills, and the technology component, and how we can get some of these ideas together in some lesson plans. So ear training, that's a kind of a loaded word. In music technology, has anyone taken a music tech class, an electronic music class before, in undergrad or any other place? Is anyone familiar with the term audio signal flow? Okay, can someone tell me what audio signal flow is? Just the, you know, whatever definition. Yes?
Sound comes into a thing and you change how much sound, what it looks like, what it sounds like, and you affect it in different sequences.
Yeah, exactly. Well, sound goes in and sound goes out. So I wanted to, that's a really important part with using technology. Sound could be generated by us or an instrument, sound could be generated by the device, and then sound goes out, but we're not always understanding what's happening, and things go wrong. You record something that doesn't sound great, and there's so many steps involved in audio signal flow, so I made a flow chart that talks about what's happening. We're singing or playing an instrument into a microphone, goes into some sort of amplifier. Then there's an analog to digital conversion that happens. It gets the sound waves or sound energy into ones and zeros so our computers or devices can understand it. Whatever digital audio workstation or mixing console you're using will manipulate the audio, then it's got to go back out of those ones and zeros into basically sound energy, so it can move the air particles. So it's amplified again, then our either headphones or speaker monitors are playing. That sound energy is moving air particles into our ears. Our tympanic membrane is then, and that whole process in our ear is basically another transducer that creates auditory sensory information for our brain to interpret. All of this happens all the time, instantly, in milliseconds it's happening. And that auditory sensory information is then, we have to perceive and be cognizant of what we're hearing, and we apply music theory to what we're hearing. We can hear what instruments we're listening to. And how we're using the technology is really important. These are the factors involved in that chain, and a lot of things can go wrong. Have any of you heard of any of these topics before? Are any of them new to you? Does anyone have any questions about something up here? It's the reasons why we choose the microphones that we're using and why we're placing it. And sometimes, in my experience, students are not always aware of the technology they're using and how they're using it. The other aspect I want to talk about with the ear training is it's not just audio signal flow I want to talk about, but audio music flow. Where is the music throughout this entire chain? Are any of you familiar with audiation? Yes. So to combine these two ideas, I decided to come up with a few examples of music technology audiation so students can hear what they're doing when they're interacting with the technology. It's not just button pushing, but there's music happening in their mind as they're working with technology. This is an audio waveform. Is it musical? What musical information can you see up there?
Yeah. Dynamics?
Yeah. Speed, there might be a regular time, there might be rests or rhythms we might be able to decipher from this. Let's take a listen, see what it sounds like. Hear the dynamics right there? Now, I have another waveform. Oh, that's the original sound. This is the other waveform. What's different? Oh, dynamics. What can we predict it's going to sound like? Yeah, it's going to be louder. In music notation, we would probably use accents to talk about it. We would use dynamic markings like forte, mezzo forte, piano. In music technology, how are we going to manipulate dynamics? Can anyone think of an audio editing process that can create that second waveform? Yes.
Compression?
Yeah. Is maybe another way? Yeah, amplitude, simply highlighting the smaller waveforms and adding gain to them. You can do automation as well. This happened to be compression with makeup gain. Because what happens with compression is you get the big waveforms. You set a threshold and a ratio to say how much you're gonna bring those big waveforms down to match the smaller waveforms, and then you add gain to the whole signal again. And that's what happened here, and it sounds like this. So musically, we had a dynamic range like this, and now we have this much dynamic range between all the beats. You can see that, and even predict what it sounds like without even having to press play. So are our students doing that? when they're interacting with technology? Are we teaching our students to find the music in the technology? Here's another example. Can anyone tell me what this song is? The piano roll on the left. Mary Had a Little Lamb. Okay. And what's the difference? Is it the same? Not the same? Not the same. Okay. Musically, what can we predict about it? Yeah, we can call it a key change. Can someone tell me specifically what note is different?
It's a minor key.
It's a minor key, exactly. And can we hear what it sounds like if it was minor already? The piano roll's telling us there's a half step difference right there. We can visually see that half step difference. Without even having to press play, we can, again, figure out musicality in the computer. As a little short vocal sample, what can you tell me about the style? Yeah, R&B. What can you tell me about the room the singer is in? I'll play it again. Can you picture, imagine a vocalist singing in front of a microphone? What type of room are they in? Yeah, probably a studio, a vocal booth. It's just a dry sound. Oh. What about that? Oh yeah, we added reverb. Too much reverb, actually. But how would you, can you imagine the type of room that this person is singing in now? Probably a lot of high ceilings. I actually used a cathedral convolution reverb sample. And what's happening is it's getting the original dry sound and it's acting as if, it's recreating if that sound was originally played in that cathedral. And so we have all these reflections in against the wall and the ceiling. What's the waveform gonna look like? Can we predict what the waveform's gonna look like after applying the reverb, it's gonna look like this again? What's gonna be different?
Will the echo have like a shadow or something?
Okay, it'll be a shadow. There'll be a decay that's happening, and so the waveform will be longer. What else about the waveform do you think will be different? Because there's these nice curves that are going up to describe the waveform. It'll be that nice and pretty. It'll be a little bit more complex because it includes all those reflections that weren't there before. So this is an example of using our ear to predict what the technology is going to tell us. So it's a two-way street of using our ear when we're interacting with technology. A couple more examples. This is, it's really small, but this is a MIDI drum map on the left, it says kick and snare, then hi-hat, and then hi-hat open it up top. Can you all predict what this sounds like? Yeah? Actually, let's do a little experiment. Who wants to beatbox what this sounds like? Anyone? You want to do it as a group? Sure, okay. Nice, steady tempo. One. Two, ready, go. Yeah, we can see it. We don't have to see the rhythms, the notation to tell us what's going on. But let's look at something else. This one's gonna look almost the same, but it's not the same. Let me put them side by side for you. It's much easier to see if you're right up next to it, the computer screen. But from here, can someone tell me what's different? Yes, it's more evenly spaced. In MIDI or digital audio, how do you think we'll get the rhythms to be evenly spaced?
It's quantized.
Yeah, it's quantized. And you can look at the MIDI data and it'll show you it's not right on the grid. And we can also use our ear to determine the rhythm. So it sounds like someone was playing a drum set pattern on a MIDI keyboard. And so we want to fix that. We want our students to be able to hear that the rhythm is not even, even though the rhythm is technically correct. And we want something more like this. Okay. One last example. Can someone make any musical assumptions about what's happening here on this? It's not quite a spectrogram, this is just frequencies on an equalizer. We can't tell too much musically about it. Is it a single instrument?
No,
probably not. Why not?
There's too much, like, the whole range.
Exactly. It's the whole spectrum is being used, and a single instrument would have its fundamental, and then maybe some overtones, but it wouldn't be like this. Now, what if it was animated like this? What's happening to the sound? Yeah. It's being filtered. So let me play the original sound first. Okay. So I want everyone to close their eyes for just a moment and imagine what that sound would sound like, filtered, how we saw animated before. At the high frequencies, and then it just expanded. Okay, let's see what it sounds like. Hear what it sounds like. So, we were able to tell some information and even use our imagination to predict what the sound was going to sound like. This is the sort of relationship that I want to build in my students in terms of using their ear when using the technology and having that two-way communication where the technology is also telling them musical information that they can see and hear. So what happens when we're audiating an audio signal flow? So audiation is a process of assimilating and comprehending music. But in the context of a technology class, it's doing the same thing, but we have to know that audio signal flow and where the music is happening throughout the entire audio signal flow. When we have any filters, EQs, compression, how are you affecting the dynamics? Are you affecting the style if we're quantizing it too straight? Did we want a loose drum sound? We want our students to be having these conversations when they're using technology. We want our students to be listening and reading and writing music with technology. And it may not be your traditional instrument or your traditional paper and pencil for notation. But that doesn't mean the technology reason doesn't have musical information that we can work with. We want our students to use their ears to know what is familiar and what is unfamiliar, so they can discern for themselves and hopefully predict in the future. Even if they're using different technology, they can predict what's going to happen. And that anticipation part is really important. Just like in ideation, there's verbal association and symbolic association in terms of learning musical terms and learning what music notation is. There's an equivalent when using music technology. Being able to know what all the sliders and knobs, not only what their names are for an LFO, you know, low frequency oscillator that you may use in a synthesizer, not only knowing what the word means, but how it's going to affect the sound. And then we have different feedback that the different forms of feedback that the computer's giving us to give us visual information about what's happening musically. So the view meter would tell us dynamics. EQ will tell us some timbral information, you know, at least. And it can get a little bit more complicated after that. So I want us to understand that in an ear training class or musicianship class, all the stuff on the left is typically what's going to be discussed. And I want, in a music technology class, to also think about ear training for music technology, not just music technology for ear training. So we're making musical connections about all of these digital tools that we're using in the classroom. And again, that verbal and symbolic association between all of these parameters and all of the music that happens within those parameters. So how do we teach music technology and musicianship skills in a comprehensive curriculum? Does anyone have any ideas or approaches that they use right now? Has anyone attempted something? Yes. Composition is great. Do you use a specific pedagogy approach?
pedagogical approach? I start with like a more simple, like loop-based technology. Mm-hmm. I use a card box with my students as like a kind of like introduction to looping. And then we do sound trap later on in the year so they can see the visual on the
station. That's awesome. Yeah, sound trap's really convenient because it's online. Does anyone have any other approach? We mentioned composition. Any other approach of musicianship with technology?
Just using like loops and form.
Oh yeah, form, yeah. Form analysis, that can all be done by ear, easy. So probably the first place we want to go when designing a curriculum like this is the national standards. Because we have grading, performing, and responding. And we have that connecting component that makes sure we're doing all three together throughout the curriculum. And then those standards expand. We have anchor standards, actually 11 of them. And if you go on NAFME's website, there's even each one of these little boxes probably has 20 bullet points and suggestions on how to implement every level in your classroom. It's called the Technology Strand Proficient PDF. Is basically what it's up on the NAFME website. So I want to show you some lesson plans that I've used in my classroom to incorporate some of this, these things I'm talking about. So I'm going to jump out and go in. Actually, no, before doing that, let's take a listen.
Thank you.
Okay, who here is familiar with that song? Okay, quite a few people. What was the instrumentation? What was happening? What specifically, what acoustic instruments were happening? What electronic instruments? Okay, acoustic guitar. Yeah. What about the electronic instrument?
Synthesizer.
Yeah, synthesizer, at least. It's probably monophonic analog synthesizer of some kind. And then there was also drums, electric bass. What was the role of the synthesizer?
Melodic.
It was melodic, yeah. Was it improvised? Was it melody? Yeah, it's probably melody. What did you like about the interaction between the acoustic instruments and the electronic instruments? Did they go well together? Did they contradict each other? Oh, yeah, that's a great word to describe what's happening, the conversation that's happening between the synthesizer and the acoustic guitar. If you hear the rest of the song, you'll actually hear the acoustic guitar get its own break, and the synthesizer get its own break, and they're going back and forth like you would in a conversation. So, let me jump into logic. Has anyone used logic before? Okay, a few people. This is a lesson plan called Synthesizer Hide and Seek. And the goals that I want, Synthesizer Hide and Seek, I want my students to be able to figure out how to navigate, be it Logic or GarageBand or any other DAW, and rather than doing the file, new track, and then software instrument and all that, that has to happen somewhere. But I want them to have fun as they learn how to use the software. I want them to learn some music skills while going about it. So after doing a small demonstration of how to add a synthesizer track, I come up with basically a hide and seek game. On the left, I have, under the navigation of sounds, I'll do a limitation where it says synthesizers and lead. And it has a list of synthesizers right there. I give a limitation to my students to only use the synthesizers in that folder. And we're going to be able to use our ears to determine what synthesizer is being used and what musical information is happening in these short examples that I create. These are examples that you would want to create for your class based on the songs that you're working on and whatever level your students are at. So here's just this first example. Okay, so what's the musical information there? What may I be teaching and working with my students on with that example?
Scale.
It could be technique if it's beginners on piano and we're just doing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for the fingering the piano. What other musical information happened?
Articulation.
Exactly. You can even see it in the waveform a little bit. You see, zoom in. Oh, too much. You can see the separation of the staccato right there. And then the legato is also happening because all the notes are connected. What can you tell me about the synthesizer? Is anyone familiar with synthesizers enough to say anything about what's happening? Yeah?
Is it kind of a sawtooth wave?
Yeah, I believe, yes, I believe it is a sawtooth wave, and that's what's getting that crunchy sort of sound. Versus, you know, square wave, triangle wave, those are conversations we would have in the classroom so that students can differentiate what's happening. Or it's definitely not a sine wave. But the students would go through, and I'll give you an example. This was the original MIDI sound right here, but is this a sound? So we would do a series of same and not the same, and being able to differentiate the different parameters of the synthesizer. In this case, what's funny about this sound that I just played? What's happening?
It's a slow attack.
A slow attack, yeah. So we may have a conversation about ADSR. Who here is familiar with ADSR? Yeah, few people. Attack, decay, sustain, release. And all sound could be described that way, not just synthesizers. And we use articulation and dynamics in music to describe how we want our musicians to approach the note or the phrase. And we can use parameters in terms of ADSR. There's also portamento and synthesizers and how you're sliding in between the notes, just like a violinist who would talk about portamento. A couple other examples. Again, depending on what your music lessons are. So, what musical content was happening there? Yeah, we're dealing with leaps.
There's a rhythm.
Ah, there's a chord progression happening.
Cadence.
Yeah, cadence. There's a leading tone in there, so we can even just talk about tonic and dominant. Even with a very short melodic example, we can have these conversations. A couple more examples. So that's a funny synthesizer. Where do you think it's coming from, the synthesizer? What's the source of the sound for the synthesizer?
Noise.
Noise. Yeah, it's a noise generator, basically white noise. And so in this case, I don't want to talk about all the melodic and harmonic content that can have in music. What if I just want to focus on the rhythm? So the noise helps me get rid of some of the other distractions, and we can just have a conversation about rhythm, and we may do rhythmic notation. A couple more examples. Let's see. Depending on the age of your students, we can do something like this. So very basic melodies. We have another example. Again, just talking about chords and how to use them. And going back to the song. So, we don't have to learn all of the whole stick song. And maybe it could be a project to recreate just that intro. Or we can just do similarities. Is that similar to the song we just heard? And all of a sudden they're categorizing melodic and tonal patterns that they can then move on and connect in other music that they're working on. Let's not listen to that again. This is what a broad lesson plan would look like. On the QR code for the handout, I have this lesson plan on there. I'll put the QR code up again at the end. It's just the idea that we want specific musical ideas we want to work on with our students. And in this case, you need some sort of a digital tool that can do synthesizers. Even our phones or tablets have the ability to work with synthesizers. And we're going to learn how to use the music while also learning musical fundamentals that our students need to learn anyway. And in this case, depending on how much contact time you have with your students, it could be three little melodic ideas. We're going to talk about 10 melodic ideas. If your students can take your digital tools home, it could be a homework assignment. Work on some of them in class and give them the freedom to explore the technology at home so they can then make their own connections on how to use the software and hopefully have some fun as well. Have the students generate their own melodic, tonal, rhythm patterns. You can put them in small groups and have them create some and then trade their musical ideas together. And getting these small components will be the building blocks of hopefully composing a song, rather than jumping right in and just composing off the bat. We can get these music fundamentals and build up. Here's another song we're going to listen to shortly. That's a demo for. Can anyone tell me what instrument that was at the very end that did that riff?
12-string?
It's a 12-string acoustic guitar. The engineer had it in the studio and he heard the riff. He's like, it sounds like George Harrison and I have this guitar, so let's just use it. And it worked out really great. So I just want to show a short sampling project where I talk about audio editing procedures. I get just that sample
kissing you
of the vocalist.
It's all I need. I need nothing more. Can I ask of you love?
And then I do this to it.
Kissing you.
Exactly your reaction to that, how my students react when I bring that up, but we can then deconstruct and recreate what's happening here while also learning how to do some audio editing. So what that would look like, has anyone used Audacity before?
No.
So Audacity, this is what the original would look like.
Kissing you,
To get any audio, what's great about Audacity is you can use it like Microsoft Word. You're highlighting waveforms like you would text, a word, a sentence, a paragraph. And then when you apply an effect, you just have to highlight, go up to effect, and let's say I want to do reverse. And instantly, I see that audio waveform. Reverse. I like starting with Audacity because students need to understand the relationship with all the buttons they're pushing and how they're manipulating the audio. Other digital audio workstations like Pro Tools or Logic basically force you to rely on your ear as you're adding all these plugins, and it's hard to follow how you're changing and manipulating the waveform and keeping track with what's happening. So teaching each concept one at a time is very helpful for that. And also in the handout will be this lesson plan right here. Again, you need to be able to customize it to your classroom, but it's just the steps of we're talking about tone and timbre and how that connects to digital audio effects. Because there's some really silly things that happen in the example that I gave. And I actually have students sing and recreate just with their voice, talking about, oh, what's it sound to do talk in reverse? And so all the students have fun doing that. That sort of interaction can then go back into whatever original audio editing project that they may do. Which would connect to a sampling project, which we just talked about earlier. There's lots of different ways to do sampling projects. Our phones could do sampling. There's a great app called Sampling Wiz, or Sample Wiz, that lets you quickly sample on your phone. If you're on a computer, Reason, Logic, Native Instruments, there's a few other ways to do sampling. And where a project that I do for that, going back to the Logic, is I'll get my voice, and you can do this live. Sample, record. So I use my voice to do a human drum set. And then I said we can make music out of the funny voices that I'm making. After recording them, it sounds something like this. And make music out of it. And I want my students to be able to also broaden their idea, definition of what are these sounds and how can we make music with everything around us. And you can get into music concrete and using found sounds. You can get students into small groups and someone do nature sounds, someone do sounds around the house, sounds in the classroom, and sample it and put it on a keyboard and then compose your own piece. This is what that lesson plan would look like again. Those found sounds, and then let's bring the music together while also learning how to use the synthesizers and sampling. So this is all in the handout. I'll put the QR code up again. The steps for designing musicianship, these are just tips. When you design your lesson plans, identify where your students are at now and what musical content you're using in the classroom, and then how to implement it with the technology or digital tools that you're using in your classroom. I have my students focusing on listening first before pushing a button, before being able to just getting those critical listening skills for both the music and the technology. So they're understanding what's happening before they're just being hands-on with the technology. So they're informed as they're going through the lesson. I like using great examples, and then examples that even exaggerate what's happening. So if I want to talk about the vocoder effect, I can use a Daft Punk example. A lot of their music will have some sort of vocoder elsewhere. And if I wanted to show an extreme example, Emotion Heap's song, Hide and Seek, that's what it is. Hide and Seek. The entire song is a vocoder, basically electric piano and voice being morphed together. And it's a beautiful example to talk about that. If we can get our students to compose and then improvise and make a performance, too often music technology classes, they come for their final project, the students stand up and then they hit play. And then they sit there. And that's their final project presentation. But it can be a performance, it can be interactive. You can do iPad bands, multiple computers, synthesizers, instruments. There can be backing track the students created. You can have solo sections and improvisation on whatever instruments the students are using. And that could also be part of a composition project. There's lots of technology out there depending on what age group you're working with. We can have conversations about this for hours. Again, the handout will have has all of these examples. If you want to get into more advanced music, music technology stuff, here's a bunch of examples as well. If you want to get into STEAM, get into computer coding, electrical engineering, here's some examples to be able to get the students having those conversations deeper in technology, what is happening, what algorithms are being used, what circuits are being used. If you have special learners in the classroom, technology can enable them to empower them to still be musical, no matter what disability they may have. There's a lot of books out there as well. Some of you might be familiar with some of these books that have great lesson plans. Actually, lesson plans very similar to the ones that I showed you. Now, I think every single one of these books has a sampling project that's being talked about. What I'm just doing is I'm putting a twist on the conversation of making sure we have that musicianship component in all of our lessons. So these are some of the references that I use. We can have a conversation now. There's a short survey in this QR code. It'll just take a few seconds to answer. And I'll also put up the first QR code again for those who walked in late, which has my handout, which has a lot of information from the slides. And if you need to connect to the Wi-Fi, it's ATT Wi-Fi, all caps, NYSSMA 2018 is the code. At this point, does anyone have any questions about technology, about musicianship, or just anything?
It's very beginning level.
Okay.
Like, I understand how a lot of it works, but like, if you had to start from ground one, ground floor.
Starting from ground one, I want to get to know my students and let them understand that they're kind of using technology every day. So if we're talking about the phone, let's talk about the technology that's happening there. And having a conversation of where they're accessing music, using music. But getting into a lesson, there's this big hurdle of what you have access to in the classroom. That's why I use the term digital tools, and that's what we use, the NACMA uses for the standards and the music technology standard, digital tools, because it could be Chromebooks, it could be iPads. Some schools have iPads for every student, and some have outdated technology. I taught a class that was using it was Dells that were over 10 years old, and it was like an early version of Cakewalk. And I'm like, okay, let's make music. That was my first goal, make music. And then the technology is setting up realistic goals of how we're going to teach the technology and how far we can. Yeah. So it's knowing the technology you have, what tools you have available, and putting the music in first, and then slowly introducing the technology, because we can't jump at a higher level, you know, from the get-go. Yeah, so sometimes those early lessons will be, let's talk about just one technology topic and one musical topic at a time, and do that for a while. Before we build up into creating our own sessions. Okay. Yes?
Two questions. What presentation software do you use?
This is Keynote.
Cool.
Thank you. So it's got a lot of cool 3D animations. There's also at ABC animations, which are very easy to do, where you just, here's an image, I want it to move over here, and on its way I want it to flip around. It's probably about 3 clicks to do something like that. And so that's, I use some of those animations here.
Is there any sequence for intermediate advanced that is on the market or that already exists that you think is particularly good? Instead of just reaching and grabbing from all different sources? Kind of what I'm doing now.
Yeah, so grabbing from different sources is tough. I like the Teaching Music Through Composition, Bart Friedman, who presented earlier, has pretty nice sequences of if we need to extend the lessons, have that next level. I like getting one thing at a time. For the audio editing example, where I got that one vocal track, and I want my students to say, hey, there's something happening with the pitch. Let's categorize the effects. And I just use the default settings. The next level, okay, I changed the threshold on the compressor. Or I using a synthesizer. These two are similar, but one of them has a portamento change. And I want them to hear that, and I'm slowly, again, one parameter at a time, I'm teaching how to use those digital audio effects or the parameters in the synthesizers, rather than doing, okay, this is what everything else does in this giant crazy window, and then move on. I want them to actually learn what a portamento is, what the LFO can do, and we'll do a musical lesson attached to that one parameter. And that's how we slowly build up. So that would be my sequence until they know everything. But we're not going to have enough time to do that. But yeah, you can always get more advanced by adding that one more thing. Yes?
I love using Audacity. I've got kids with Chromebooks. We can't install hardware. Does anybody know, or do you know, like a web-based sound wave editing?
Soundtrap is definitely has its limitations.
Yes, it's too limited. I mean, like for what you're showing, what you're demoing,
I
can do a couple tricks, but it's not really like to do it on Audacity.
Web-based is difficult. Did anyone go to Alex Ruthman's session? I believe that was Wednesday. He showed off. MuseEdLab.org. Oh, I'm not connected. Sorry, it's connected to the internet. But MuseEdLab.org. It's a bunch of little lessons that are separated that talk about different components. There's a Peter Gabriel session where there's a lot of session files, and it'll have learning components in there. There's an online sampler we can mess around with. It's definitely worth exploring. It's not the solution that you're talking about, but in terms of, let's have a conversation about sampling, there's a web app for sampling, and you can use the QWERTY keyboard to trigger samples. And but the advanced editing, at some point, if you don't have the ability to add VST plugins in your DAW, and that is a limitation of Chromebooks. We'll get there eventually. HTML5, Web 3.0, will eventually, a web app can do anything that a computer app can do, but it's just not there yet. Especially for free resources, because that's a lot of technology to develop. So you'd probably want to look at what your resources are in terms of maybe getting a small lab together that you can work on at least just the concepts of audio editing at an advanced level, rather than focusing everything on the Chromebook. Yeah. Maybe one more question. No? Okay, that's fine. I'm going to put the QR code back up, so if anyone didn't get the presentation handout, here's that PDF. Includes many of the slides, particularly the samples, the lesson plans, the resources that you saw at the end. It also has the diagram of the audio signal flow that I'd shown earlier. Okay, thank you. And I'll be hanging around, so if you want to talk and have more conversations.